The Apple Watch is irrefutably the most popular wearable in the world by a huge margin. According to Statista, the company sold 22.5 million Apple Watches in 2018, up from an already staggering 17.7 million units sold in 2017. The Apple Watch is the sensible, the go-to smartwatch, but it's also pretty expensive. The current outgoing unit is the Series 5, which sits at £399. On top of a £1,000 smartphone, that's a bit steep in my opinion. And I noticed this, so I went to this channel's favourite website, eBay, and picked up this Series 4 44mm for around £250. Is it worth buying over the Series 5 at such a price decrease? Well, hey guys, I'm Ryan Thomas, and today we're gonna find out. Being a complete Apple Watch virgin, I came into this thinking, I'm gonna use this for a month maybe tops, I'm gonna take it off my wrist, I'm gonna put the brilliant Huawei Watch GT2 back on it where it belongs. But I was completely wrong. See, I'm an iPhone 11 user due to the fact that my job is to review Android phones. And so, one, to maintain a balanced perspective, and two, because sticking with One OS is just so boring. So naturally, the GT2 that I was using was less made for the iPhone than the Series 4. But after just 3 days with this thing on my wrist, I was convinced that I would switch to the Apple Watch ecosystem. I hate that word, but ecosystem. Oh, and by the way, I hadn't even tried out the fitness tracking features of this watch, which I think are some of the best bits. The fact that it takes up so little real estate on my wrist is an ironically massive thing for me. There are heaps and heaps of third-party screen protectors, wristbands, cases, the lot. I bought this black and grey one from Amazon and I think it complements the silver finish quite well. My unit does have a fair few scratches on the thing, on the screen in particular really, and it's something that I thought I'd hate, but I haven't really noticed it since the first day I got it. There are also a few dings in the body, see my previous comment. This thing cost me £225 on eBay with a blue watch strap, and I think it's money well spent to be quite honest. I have not had a single, oh, by the way, this thing's off, it's dead, it's out of battery, we'll talk about that later. I haven't had a single performance drop with this thing, which is weird coming from the Android Wear kind of side of things. This wasn't a problem with my Huawei Watch GT2, but it's definitely not something that Android Wear users will be used to. This thing is still buttery smooth since when I first got it, and the combination of using the touchscreen and the physical buttons and the dials, well, it's been satisfying and functional. The haptic engine in this thing is incredibly crisp, which is to be expected based on Apple's smartphone haptics. The overall user experience is something that I've never experienced with any other wearable. Fantastic stuff from such a used product. The screen itself has not suffered any dead pixels or burning, which is great to see, and the quality is really, really good, easily getting visible out in the sun. Something that's pretty incredibly rare, actually, in the UK. It's sharp, smooth, vibrant, nearly edge to edge, and a good display overall. Charging is a little bit slow on this thing. It takes around 2 hours to charge the battery from 0 to 100%, which is a little strange because there are phones out there with nearly 5,000 mAh batteries that are charging in 30 minutes. So the fact that this tiny little battery charges to 100% in 2 hours is kind of nuts, especially as it does get warm whilst doing it. And some of these smartphones don't even get a tad warm whilst charging that quickly. So maybe we'll see something in further iterations, and maybe it's to do with longevity. I would expect it's probably something to do with that. However, it does mean that when you do charge it, you kind of need to like make sure you charge it before you go out, at least 2 hours before you go out, which is a problem that I've actually run into a couple of times. What's more impactful is the toll that it takes on my iPhone's battery life, actually. So my iPhone 11 was lasting me around 2 days on average on a charge, but now I need to try hard to get this thing through a full day. That constant Bluetooth connectivity is absolutely crazy. The user interface also takes some time to get used to, but WatchOS has been super stable for me. The app integration with apps like Strava and MyFitnessPal for tracking stuff like macros or just fitness and calories has been absolutely flawless too. However, make sure that you get an iPhone 6 with iOS 12 or higher, or this thing's just not gonna work. The reason this review took so long, and I really was expecting to do the review in like a month, is that when I bought it, it was just before lockdown, and lockdown happened, and I'm the sort of person who doesn't want to go out like a lot in lockdown. I kind of want to avoid it, even if the UK has lifted a few restrictions. So it took a long time for me to actually get out, and I went on a lot of bike rides. I did like a couple of walks, but it was mostly bike rides out on my mountain bike. I just missed that so much. So I went and did that, and it's just so good. The fact that it, right in from the get-go, connecting it to Strava, it auto-stops it. It does all that automatically and then sends the data to my phone automatically and uploads it automatically. It's really good. It might not be the most accurate. However, if you're comparing the data from your watch, say a time it takes for you to go from A to B, say in a fast run or testing your mountain bike pace, because it's only so inaccurate, you can compare your previous time to your current time and you'll see a logical progression. You won't see like crazy spikes in different times, even though you're technically running faster or cycling faster, because it's comparing from the time from one watch reading on this watch to another watch reading from this watch, which makes sense. So yeah, it's not the most accurate in the world. I actually say the GT2 was better, but the integration and the fact that it does it all automatically is just something I didn't get with the GT2. However, controlling music playback on the watch was pretty awkward, and I actually don't do it. Now, I use AirPods, and so there's no real quick volume control on AirPods, so it would be better to be able to change my volume on the watch. However, with Spotify, which is my music platform of choice, it is a little bit buggy, and I guess if you were using Apple Music, it would just be really seamless. You could probably just change the volume with the crown there and it would all be seamless. But the fact that it's not working for Spotify, and when it does, you actually have to go into the app, it's not automatic like it is the other apps, it's a little bit of a shame. But it is something that I kind of understand. You know, I'm not using Apple's built-in music player, I'm using Spotify, which is an external service. Here's some used buying advice from me. You're gonna probably get quite a few scratches on yours, so make sure that you buy a screen protector. And also expect a few tiny little micro scratches when buying the thing on eBay anyway, if you are buying used. If you are buying an Apple refurbished product, you are likely going to get a brilliantly brand new rehoused watch with no problems whatsoever. But when you do that, do get a screen protector, because these things pick up micro scratches so easily. The same goes for the housing on the outside as well. Secondly, if you are buying used, 100% douse it in isopropyl or some kind of cleaning agent, and also get a new watch strap. As I said earlier, I had that blue watch strap, but I haven't used it. I took it off immediately and bought my own brand new one to put on, just for cleanliness and hygiene reasons. You don't want to be walking around with someone else's sweat on your arm. And so, should you still buy the Series 4? I think you really should. If you are an Apple user and you've been using third-party watches and you've just been thinking about buying an Apple Watch, the Series 4 is a great thing to buy, because one is significantly cheaper, almost half the price of the Series 5. You get pretty much all the functionality bar the always-on display, which I didn't find to be a problem anyway, because by the time I raised my wrist to my face, the screen was on. The battery life is fantastic, aside from it only lasting a day at a time, which is a bit of a pain. I forgot, I should have mentioned that in the battery life segment. Why did I forget that? And the fact that there are just so many different bands you can buy. I only have one, but you can get like metal bands and linked bands and rubber bands. You get leather ones, you get whatever you want. So it's really nice to have all of those options as well, because the market for third-party bands and screen protectors and cases for the Apple Watch is just huge. The tight integration with iOS is unbelievable, and it's the reason I'm not turning back to my fantastic GT2. And I think anyone who is thinking about it, you'd be very happy to get one of these things. Anyway, that about rounds out today's video. Thank you all so much for watching. I've been Ryan Thomas. Please do like, dislike, comment and subscribe if you're new around here to never miss a video like this one. And also check out all my social media links, as well as a link to buy one of these things in the video description. I want to give a massive shout out to my patrons for being continually supportive, so thank you so much for all the support recently. It's been really appreciated. I've been Ryan Thomas, and I'll see you later. Peace.